Hello and welcome to Wealth Track. I'm Consuelo Mack. How real is the retirement crisis? This headline might give you a pretty good indication. 40% of older workers and their spouses will experience downward mobility in retirement. That is 8.5 million middle-class older workers and their spouses will fall into poverty or near poverty in their old age. Those findings come from this week's guest. She is economist and retirement expert Teresa Ghilarducci, director of the Schwartz Center for Economic Policy Analysis at the New School, where she leads its Retirement Equity Lab, which researches the causes and consequences of the retirement crisis. Professor Ghilarducci has also come up with some workable solutions to the crisis. She has written extensively on the issue, including several books. The most recent is Rescuing Retirement, A Plan to Guarantee Retirement Security for All Americans, which she co-authored with Tony James, the executive vice chairman of Blackstone. And you can see my interview with Tony James on WealthTrack.com. Teresa, 40% of older workers and their spouses will experience downward mobility in retirement. What's going on?
40% of middle-class workers who are about ready to approach retirement don't have enough money in their retirement accounts or don't have any retirement accounts. So when they reach retirement age, they will only depend upon Social Security. And Social Security isn't enough to maintain a middle-class worker's retirement standard of living, you know, the standard of living they reached when they were working. And what's happening is not so much the fault of the workers who are coming into retirement. The problem is that this cohort, this generation of workers, have lived under an experiment in the United States, a kind of a do-it-yourself experiment, where governments have shrunk their pensions, especially Social Security, but also Medicare premiums went up. And companies have moved away from offering or expanding their retirement options. And so for the past 40 years, the boomer generation has really had to know the ropes and started saving from the moment they started working and kept that money in an account almost every year, you know, for 42 years for the system to have work for them, because that's unrealistic. We're now seeing the result of that do-it-yourself pension experiment we've been conducting for the past 40 years.
This experiment is really for those who are lucky enough to have an employer-sponsored plan, a 401k, and of course, IRAs are relatively new as well. But what about the rest of us, those who aren't covered? Is their predicament worse or better than it was, let's say, 40 years ago?
We were never in a golden age of retirement, let's say in the 70s and 80s, because not everybody was covered by a supplemental plan on top of Social Security. But the numbers were a lot larger than people thought. At any one point in time, there were about 60% of workers were covered by a defined benefit plan. But by the time a worker reached retirement, the chances that they had passed through an employer that had a defined benefit plan or somewhere along the way they collected vesting benefits was far higher than half. It was about 70%. And also those defined benefit plans were valuable if you were vesting towards the end of your working life, and that's when people would stop shopping for jobs and stay with an employer, you know, for a period of time. So the data is quite remarkable, because I see retirees now who are living on a DB plan. Now, they're not rich on a DB plan, but they have spousal benefits, so a surviving spouse would have a steady income for the rest of their lives and sitting on top of Social Security. And the chances that someone with a modest DB plan would be poor in retirement is almost zero. They're kind of lower middle class workers with a DB plan. You remain a lower middle class retiree. Where we're seeing a lot of risk of poverty are older people who have some defined contribution plan or nothing at all. Because when you get older, that money runs out, or when you're living alone, and the money is has already run out, and you actually have a little bit more expenses when you're living alone, because two people can live a lot cheaper per person than one person. So there, the defined benefit system was not perfect, but it was much, much better than the system we have now.
Your thesis is that it's not our fault, that basically it's the do-it-yourself system is this experiment, as you've described it, that really is the main problem. But when I look at the savings rates, for instance, and this has been something that, you know, for the last 40 years, as a matter of fact, that the savings rates of the U.S. have overall declined, and you're an economist, so you tell me if that's accurate. But isn't it also the case that we've become, you know, much more consumer-oriented, and that, in fact, that we're not saving enough? Don't we share some of the responsibility for our retirement security?
The idea that we can blame the victim, you know, this generation of workers without enough savings in their voluntary accounts, is the first place I went to as well. You know, we're ruining the environment with our consumerism in the third world. And was there something about credit cards and advertising and even social media that made us more present-minded or wanting more immediate gratification? And the research just doesn't show that's true, that humans really haven't changed that much over the past, you know, 70 years. We were, when we had a defined benefit system and longer-term relationships with our employer, which actually provide a platform to save for retirement, humans were just as impulsive as they are now. So what has caused the big break is that we don't have the institutions that help people save. And that explains the decline in the savings rate and the accumulation for retirement, not a change in personality. Also, you would think that people in France or Italy, places where the joy of living is even better, have better institutions for retirement savings. So if we think that that Americans are pretty much facing the same kind of cultural changes that other Europeans are, it's really the Americans that have really fallen off. And it's institutional. But the idea of blaming the victim and wanting to be able to control our own destiny, that's an important human reaction, is to say, hey, if I just saved more, if I do save more, I can save myself. The flip side of that is to blame yourself and to not be accurate in blaming really the victim. It's our failed system that's flawed, not flawed human beings. And even if we are flawed human beings, we should have systems that that help us do the right thing. And I can tell you what kind of system we need, but we have been moving away from a well-designed system for the past 40 years.
Let's quickly address the system failures, and you've written extensively about two of the major ones, which is one is lack of coverage, the access to the employer-sponsored retirement plans, that there is a real lack of coverage. And the other one is, as you just referred to, the switch to the 401ks, the defined contribution versus the defined benefits, is flawed because it's, you know, it's voluntary, it's easy to withdraw, you get a lump sum at the end. There are all sorts of hazards there. So do you want to just quickly address the failures of this do-it-yourself retirement system?
Yeah, that was so well said. First, only half of workers are covered by a 401k system. But even if everyone was covered by a 401k system, and we implemented these laws that opted everybody into a 401k or even an individual retirement account, the system would still fall short because of the structure of the system. And the system failed in three ways. A system has to be able to help people accumulate enough money for over their entire working life. And most people want to. Nobody is clamoring to make Social Security, for instance, voluntary. People want to be personally responsible in part for their own retirement, and they're willing to save. We see that over and over in surveys. But we have to have a system that helps people accumulate. The second thing a good system has to do is help people invest every dollar they save for retirement for the long term well and efficiently. And the 401k IRA system is just terrible at helping people invest securely and efficiently. And third, people don't want to get rich on their retirement savings. They want to be secure. And so there's no way, as you pointed out, that a lump sum can, through an individual's effort, be transferred into an efficient annuity or lifelong monthly benefit on their own because of all the problems with somebody having to go out into the insurance market and buying a single insurance plan. Health insurance that's not group health insurance is much more expensive. So is an individual annuity. So the 401k IRA system is an individual account that a person has to decide to contribute to with or without the help of their employer. The person has to direct their investments that even professionals have a difficulty time doing. They have to live their lives as American workers do. And when they are faced with losing their house or having to fund a transition from job to job, then having money available, taking it out of the retirement plan, isn't a matter of immediate gratification or some kind of flaw. It's rational. It's just sitting there. And the third thing is that we have a system that's built for people at 65 having $100,000, $200,000, maybe even $1 million in their account right at the time that they are quite vulnerable. Not only are they aging and at risk of cognitive decline, they are also at a period of time where they may be alone. So we're basically setting up our seniors to be prey to predators. In the United States, we have 5 times the amount of financial abuse of seniors than you see in other countries. And that's basically because our system like pins $1,000 bills to the shirt jacket, lapels of our elders, send them on a bus and say, hey, you better get financially literate out there and manage your money. It just isn't a system that is reality-based, that is based on the realities of the workplace or the realities of what older people need.
You mentioned the fact that it's not because somebody has an impulse to go out and spend madly that they raid their 401k accounts. And you and your team at the New School published a paper analyzing retirement savings. And your conclusion basically was that if you looked at all income levels, that no one is safe, that basically stuff happens. So what are the kinds of events that, enable us or kind of necessitate us going into our savings accounts before we are even in retirement?
Yeah, well, none of us are immune to stuff. There are 3 things that happen that really seem to drain accounts. One is job loss or a loss in hours or even not being able to get an inflation increase. Wages have stagnated for the past 40 years, and it's really hard to save when you don't get a raise. The third thing that happens is that people get a divorce, and a divorce, especially in middle age, can have your assets. Recessions happen. Recessions can wipe out your financial account at the same time it wipes out your ability to get a raise or to find a job if you lose it. And the other thing that happens, even though it's less prevalent, but I suspect it will increase more, is that people do have health and disability incidences, even if it's not permanent, that makes them have to withdraw from the labor force for their own disabilities, temporary or permanent, and also their spouses. So that we are a community of human beings that need to take care of other human beings, and we also are on the mercy of the economy and our employers, and frankly, on whether or not our skills continue to be in demand in the marketplace or whether or not they depreciate very, very fast. And these are all things that are really out of the control of an individual. And those are the things that make our retirement savings very vulnerable to leakage. But that vulnerability to leakage of your retirement account affects people whether they're poor, middle class, or even the very rich. It's just that people in the bottom 80% of the distribution, 80, 90% of the distribution, just are more likely to have more of those things, more job loss, more depreciation of their skills, and just more vulnerable.
There are several fixes that are commonly mentioned out there, and one is, and I've talked to guests on WealthTrack about them, you know, one is that to make participation in 401ks mandatory, to make the contribution, you know, larger than 1.5% of your income. Another one is to insist that everyone work longer. What about those partial solutions? Why don't you think they will be effective?
Let me talk about what we need to do as a nation, just public policy. And let me talk about also what individuals can do while we wait around for the politicians to act. The first thing we need to do is to get everybody savings at the very beginning of their work life. We went halfway by having everybody in Social Security for every single hour they work, whether it's gig work or independent contracting work, self-employment, or, you know, regular employment. So everybody's in, you know, from the first moment that they start working. We need to do that with a pension plan.
Let's talk about solutions. I mentioned in my introduction to you that you and Tony James, the executive vice chairman of Blackstone, have written a terrific book called Rescuing Retirement. And in it, you do have a solution, and you call the solution to the do-it-yourself retirement system that is broken, according to you and Tony James. It's called Guaranteed Retirement Accounts, GRA. What are they?
Our national solution to this retirement crisis is a pensions for all plan, where everybody would have an individual account called a guaranteed retirement account from the very first moment they start to work. You start paying into Social Security and you start paying into your guaranteed retirement account. Your employer also pays into the retirement account like your employer does for your Social Security. We propose that we start at a minimum of 1.5% for each of the employee and the employer. For a young person who starts at that level, they could, you know, just ratchet that up gradually over time, and they would be able to maintain their living standards. For most of us, we would want to contribute a lot more than just the total 3%, 5%, even 6%, 7% would make us really comfortable in retirement. So we would get everybody in and everybody saving, employer and employee. We would also have these accounts professionally managed, so a worker wouldn't have to decide whether or not they should have equities, bonds, this kind of equity, that kind of bond. They'd be tempted to time the markets. We just have a track record to show that individuals don't do as well as professionals. We would also have a board that would make sure that the choices people had to invest in or the kinds of managers would be highly regulated. We don't have that kind of guarantee now. And at the end of their working life, they would be able to take that lump sum and convert it into a guaranteed annuity for life, just like Social Security is guaranteed. So they wouldn't have to worry about being old and suffering through a recession. So that's what a guaranteed retirement account is. And it's a bold plan. I think several politicians are interested in that plan. And also Republicans and Democrats are interested in that plan. The politicians are, and so are voters, because it folds in and adds in personal responsibility along with help with a well-designed structure or platform.
And I might add that among the benefits which you've, one is that it's self-funding because the worker and the employer are contributing to it kind of from the get-go or whenever they start. And also it's paid through the Social Security system, so you're not creating a new bureaucracy, right?
That's exactly right. Your pension plan can never be underfunded. It's self-funding. There's no exposure for the government. And the Social Security system is so efficient. You know, it knows your number. It knows where you work. It already tracks, you know, your employment. And so just adding that administrative addition, which is not that expensive, means that we bypass a lot of the administrative costs. So it's a system that other countries have, and it's a system that a lot of workers have when they work for big firms. We're just extending that efficient system, you know, kind of a pyramid system, Social Security on the bottom and a well-funded, well-managed pension plan, you know, in the middle for all workers.
And I'll add the it's well-funded, but the well-managed is my understanding is that the default manager would be your state pension plan, which actually have pretty good track records, certainly much better than the track records of the 401k investments.
Right. You know, there are about 170 state and local pension plans, and by far most of them are very well managed, and only a few aren't funded. But the underfunding that you hear about in New Jersey and Illinois isn't the fault of the management. It's the fault of the governors and the legislatures not funding them enough. So most of the state and local pension plans are very well managed because they're big. We also are looking into adding a default manager being the thrift savings plan, you know, that has a long-term investment sidecar add to it. The thrift savings plan is what federal workers you know, save through. So a worker would be able to choose who their manager is, but the default, if they don't choose, would be their state pension plan.
In the meantime, Teresa, we are living with a flawed system that is not working well for many Americans. So what can we do as individuals if we're near retirement? What can we do to help bulk up our retirement savings and plan?
If you're young, it's easy for me to give advice, you know, and I don't even bother here, but it's about letting compound interest, you know, work for you. Save a little bit, 5%. Don't look at it. Don't time it. You know, go to Vanguard, go to index funds. It's just a lot easier to talk to a young person. It's harder, I have to admit, and it's just very difficult to talk to an older person who might have just gotten a divorce or has a skill that they just know is not that marketable in the marketplace. So if they're 55, and I know, I'm pretty sure there's going to be a recession coming up in a year, my advice is to really downsize your living standards, really do whatever you need to do, you know, Buddhism, you know, a mindfulness, you know, really reassess what your spending pattern is, get a budget, do all those hygienic things for your budget so that you don't sacrifice yourself or feel deprived or put upon. Mindfully, with your own power and choice, bring down your spending. And that's where personal responsibility, but also psychology, even brain chemistry, is really necessary here. I don't want to make people feel just crushed by, you know, personal austerity, but it is important to get your spending down. It's important to try to work as much as you can into your 60s. And I know that's very hard for some people and impossible for others. It's important to know that delaying your Social Security, your own worker benefit and Social Security, can have a huge payoff. So even if, let's say, you're 62 and you have $40,000 in your IRA or your 401k, I would suggest living on that with a little bit of work, maybe bringing in a boarder, doing a little gig work, anything you can to delay even 6 months or a year. If you have $100,000, delay your collection for 3 years. If you have $200,000, try to delay all the way up to 70. For everybody with a worker benefit, waiting to collect means that you earn a guarantee of 6.75 to 8%, depending upon when that delayed retirement year is. So what you want to do is try to bridge the gap between your full-time work and your collection of Social Security. I mean, you can retire, but you don't have to collect Social Security. Your full benefit will come when you're 70. And that, for someone who doesn't have a college degree, it is very unusual to be able to find work, you know, work that isn't just awful, all the way up to 70. I also recommend that people don't rely on a reverse mortgage, you know, sometime in their future. They're a lot more risky than people realize. First of all, a lot of housing that older people are in isn't appropriate for an older person. It might be when you're 55, it's totally inappropriate when you're 75. And reverse mortgages rely on people thinking that their house is going to go up in value. And a lot of houses don't go up in value. And we saw a lot of the American housing stock fall in value in the recession and stay down for a while. So it's better when you're healthy and you can manage it, is to downsize sort of earlier in your retirement life and not wait till you're 70 or 80. So those are that's my suggestion.
Let's discuss the outlook for a recession. And you told me that you went to a conference of economists recently, and the majority of them are now predicting a recession in 2020. What do people in retirement, or actually, what do people planning for retirement do in the event of a recession?
Well, first of all, when you're in a recession, the values of your stocks and your bonds are going to fall. So you're going to see a decline in the value of your portfolio. You really don't want to have to sell those assets when they're falling in value to pay for bills that you anticipated. So I would hope that people try to pay off their mortgage or get rid of their fixed expenses right before a recession. For a lot of people, it's their mortgage. For other people, it could be car loans or other kinds of debt. So get out of debt, no matter what kind of debt it is, as fast as you can while you still have your job and you still have some flexibility. So you don't want to get into a recession in debt. And you also want to be psychologically prepared that you don't panic. If you don't have to take out your money when your accounts fall, then you aren't losing what you think you're losing on paper. You know, they're not realized losses yet. So if you can hang on, it's likely in a couple of years your assets will come back. Now, you won't have as much as you had planned, but you won't have that kind of drop that you had. So I would right now try to reduce your debt and actually go to your basic spending as if we were in a recession now. You know, cut the cable now. Fall in love with your stuff. Like, get all your stuff out of your closet and your house, and just, like, you know, pour a glass of wine and, you know, bring your stuff some flowers. But really get rid of the impulse to buy new stuff. That consumer discretion money can really hurt your budget. Learn how to cook. And then if you kind of prepare for the austerity that a recession might have, then you'll feel more in control. Lately, I've really been concerned about the data we're seeing about depression, kind of low-level depression among the elderly. And a lot of that is because of shame and a feeling that people don't have as much control over their life, you know, the locus of control. And if people are savvy to know that they're at risk for that, they might be able to prevent that.
Great advice, Teresa. Thank you so much for joining us. And I'll tell our audience, this has been Teresa Ghilarducci. She's the director of the Schwartz Center for Economic Policy Analysis at the New School and head of its Retirement Equity Lab. She is the author of many books, the most recent being Rescuing Retirement with Tony James. And it is a terrific book with solutions for our retirement crisis. And I hope it gets traction in Washington. Thank you so much, Teresa, for joining us on WealthTrack.
You're welcome. It was really great to talk to you.
Thank you for joining us on this WealthTrack webcast with Teresa Ghilarducci from the New School. And as we said, her book, Rescuing Retirement, is worth reading. And we will have links to her and to it on our website, WealthTrack.com. And as we say at the end of every WealthTrack program, make the week ahead a profitable and a productive one.